Thank you. Thanks, Tugu. Thanks, everyone, for turning up today. And look, Tugu has mentioned it, but obviously it was quite a decision to make to move the AGM to Westport. There's a couple of reasons. I mean, we have been getting regular visits from a couple of different parties within, particularly based in Wellington, who aren't particularly enamoured with our operations. And Fiona and I and a couple of others have actually taken the paint off our front door a couple of times over the last 6 months or so. So when we were lining up to do the organisation for this, it was going to actually mean quite a lot of more security than what we've had in the past to be able to guarantee the safety of our staff and of our shareholders who wish to attend the meeting. And then we thought, well, you know, as Tugu said, let's go back to where we originally started and where our support base is in terms of local communities. And rather than spending money in Wellington on extra security, you know, we'll book out half the motels in town and have a couple of meals and welcome the shareholders who want to come. But then the kicker for that is then you also get a trip to Stockton if you can afford the time. So that's the reason why we've done it. And we'll see where we end up next year as to where we go from there. Usual disclaimers. There will be a number of forward-looking statements as part of this presentation. Resource and reserves are based around our latest update, which was put out on the end of October. And there is an intermixing of Bathurst and BT. And I think everyone understands that, you know, Bathurst owns 65% of the BT business, which is Rotowaro, Maumarua and Stockton. So just a quick look at the results from last year. Obviously, these were all released as part of the full year results back in September. But just to recap, you know, we had two quite large investments during the year. We had our investment in Crown Mountain, which we'll talk about in a bit more detail towards the end. And obviously we also then took over all of the equipment and the guys from Rotowaro on the 19th of November last year. So, you know, that was about a $20 million investment in the gear, plus then we've moved quite a bit of dirt in the meantime, and that's quite a lot that's gone onto the balance sheet, so it's been a large investment. We did a share buyback during the year. We made $107 million EBITDA and $45 million net profit. We received a innovation award as part of the New Zealand Minerals Forum for Canterbury Coal and the mining and the planning process that goes in there. And of course, we've now paid the dividend, but we announced the dividend as part of those full year results, and that's our maiden dividend. Part of the sort of the rebirth of Bathurst back in 2015, it was a rebirth of the board. Tuku took over as chairman. Russell and Peter joined us on the board, and I took over as CEO. At that time, we sat down with board and senior management, and we looked at the strategy of the company that was in place, and we basically turned that on its head. And we've gone through that many a time. But really, the idea was to sweat the domestic assets, make money out of that, and then that gave us then the right to grow out of that skin rather than relying on shareholders' money. And even by that time, shareholders' money had, you know, the access to that money had dried up fairly significantly. And the Buller project at that point in time was unfinanceable given the coal price where it was and the amount of capital that was going to be required to build it. So that strategy was put in place, and the three main pillars were, as I said, to sweat that domestic business and make money out of it, get access into the export coking coal trade, and also get more involvement in the North Island asset, either by bringing South Island coal into the North Island, displacing imports at the time, or as we've done, developing new assets or purchasing new assets. So obviously come now forward to 2017, we've achieved that. We've taken over the assets of Solar Energy. We've got we produce 100% of the coal that's produced in the North Island. We're doing 1.2 million tonnes worth of export out of coking coal out of the South Island, and we're making money out of our domestic business. So again, as a board and management, we review this every year. And as part of this year's review, we're sort of really refining those pillars. So it comes down to our key target is to take the company to producing under management 5 million tonnes by FY23. And doing that, though, in a way where we've got a cost structure that's sustainable through the highs and lows of the domestic coal industry and the export coal industry. We want to be focused on our environmental responsibilities. And then probably the key part in terms of actually managing our operations is that health and safety will be embedded in everything we do. It's not an add-on, it's not the first thing we do. It is a priority, but it's actually embedded in everything we do. So it becomes part of how we do business rather than being another thing and then we go and mine some coal. We mine coal safely. And obviously encompassing all that is doing it in a way where we've identified the risk and we've got controls in place that are constantly being reviewed. We want to actually, you know, develop and maintain the domestic business, and as we'll see as we go forward in the presentation, that's a really important part of our strategy because it underpins the business. But then also we want to grow on the export relationships that we've already got through solar energy, but also through now through our advancement into Canada. And then underpinning that is we've got to get the costs right, we've got to drive that through, and we've got to be compliant with our own systems and the regulations. We want to actually do the best we can with the New Zealand assets that we already hold, and we also then want to grow into the international coking coal. I mean, that's where we see the growth of this company, and as we'll talk about as we go further forward, we've got 74% of our revenue now coming from coking or steelmaking coal sales, and we want to grow that to 90%. We don't want to grow up to 90% though by decreasing the amount that we're doing in the domestic. We want to grow it by doing more international coking coal sales, and so that leads us into another project as we'll see. We've got a number of customers and both domestically and export wise that have been with the company since the inception, since we came into New Zealand in 2010, and just as importantly with the purchase of Stockton, we've picked up customers now that have been with Stockton for 40 plus years. So some of the Japanese customers in particular are now 45 years next year. Tata Sail out of India have been customers for 20 years plus. So those long-term relationships are the ones we want to build on. And we're going to do that in a way that doesn't hurt people, doesn't hurt the environment, and we want to be an employer that people want to come and work for. So we want to be able to maintain the base that we've got here in Stockton, we want to maintain the base that we've got in Takitimu and Canterbury, and then do the same thing in the North Island and ultimately into Canada. So I think one of the key things that makes Bathurst different than a lot of other companies is that we've got this diverse base. So we've got 40% of our revenue at the moment coming from domestic sales within New Zealand and 60% coming from export. So with those domestic sales, I mean, they're longer term contracts and the prices are fixed. And our costs are relatively fixed because we control the mine plan. And the biggest driver on costs in an open cast coal mine is how much dirt you've got to move to get to each tonne of coal. So, you know, we understand that when we're entering the contracts. And I think in terms of going forward, one of the key changes that we've made in our sort of dealings with some of those customers is that we're not going to go out at traditionally what an exploration company does is drill holes all over the place, you know, finding coal and building up a resource and a reserve base, and then basically developing mine out of that. We've got the resource base, we've got a reserve base that sits in behind our existing contracts, and any new contractor going forward or any new customer will have to be engaged with us at the start before we can then enter into a reserve conversion. So we don't want to end up with stranded assets. If they want the coal, we'll continue to supply them the coal. If for whatever reason, whether it's government policy or their own policy within their company, then and they don't want to buy a coal office, well then we'll move on to other parts of the business. And that's been demonstrated with our New Zealand Steel recontracting of the Rotowaro mine. So we had a cutback, we went back to them, it was a high strip ratio cutback. We needed an increase in price before we were even going to enter into doing the works to actually bring that project on, and particularly before we went and bought the gear off this contractor. They entered into that negotiation in good faith, and we came out the other side of it with an increase in coal price, and they've got security of supply for another 4 years. So it's a win-win for both parties. So that's the way we want to work forward with our major customers. With the export business, we see there's always going to be a need for coking coal. I mean, any new economy going forward or any shape, colour of economy is going to need steel. You know, whether it's for EVs, whether it's for windmills, rails to replace roads, whatever it might look like, it's going to need steel. And coking coal still provides most of the base of iron that's produced that goes into steel across the world. So we've got assets in New Zealand, obviously, that we want to continue to bring forward. And then we're also looking to grow the company. That's why we're looking at this Canadian asset. So at the present time, as I said, we've got around about 75% of our revenue coming from steelmaking, 20% from food manufacturing, and about 6% this year, or looking forward, coming from the Genesis Power Station at Huntly. In terms of sort of at-risk type revenue, yes, 60% of it comes from export, but we also do hedge. So we hedge about 30-odd percent of our sales going forward. So really that brings our sort of at-risk revenue down to 50%, so it gives us the upside when the price goes up, and it limits the impact on the company if the price drops below a certain level. Our guidance has been out since quarter one. We've reviewed it again as part of putting this presentation together. Even though the international coal price has come back a little bit, as I said, we've got hedging in place that takes us forward to next June at quite good pricing. And we're anticipating that that price is going to come back to around about 160 in the quarter three and four. And I'll talk about that a bit more in a second. Our underpinning domestic business, we made $39 million EBITDA at Bathurst level out of that last year. It's going to be slightly down this year because we've had to pull back some production out of Canterbury while we work through some consenting issues there. And also we've got a high strip ratio block in our K1 block in Maramarua. Now we're anticipating that's going to come back to pretty much this level next year. We'll get past the issues with Canterbury and we'll actually be some of the repayment back, some of the early overburden we're bringing forward now. We'll get the payback of that next year at Maramarua. Maramarua's got our longest standing contracts, it's our longest term contracts with Fonterra, and it's got a very stable business. So the export price has come back. We've sort of been cycling the last couple of months between 130 to 150. It's on the rise again at the present time. There's been a sort of a general squeezing of the steel price internationally, and obviously there's some macro economic things going on with the trade war between US and China. There's also been port restrictions in China, which have restricted them out of the spot trade that's going into the East Coast ports of China. We're also seeing that with the squeezing of the steel price, the iron ore price though has stayed actually remarkably high. It's still over $80 US. So in reaction to that, particularly in India, what we're seeing is that the major producers are actually working their stocks down. They're working their stocks down in iron ore. They're also working their stocks down in coking coal. At some point in time, they're going to have to restock. And all these people know that there's a high reliance on seaborne trade out of the east coast of Australia, particularly out of Queensland. And if there's any sort of minor interruption, even during the cyclone season going through Queensland, we potentially will see some large fluctuations in pricing. So they will not want to be exposed to that. So we do believe, and I think general pundits believe, that there will be an increase in price, an increase in trade going on in quarter three and quarter four in the next the remainder of the financial year. The L&M Coal Holdings court case, I think most people in the room will know, but just to give you a really, really brief overview of this, back in 2010, the deal that brought Bathurst into New Zealand was the Buller project. It was purchased off L&M Coal Holdings for a nameplate $120 million US. There was three payments involved in that structure. $40 million paid when the bankable feasibility was signed off, $40 million paid when 25,000 tonnes had been shipped from the project, and then another $40 million when 1 million tonnes had been shipped from the project. The DFS was signed off in 2010, that money was paid. We got caught up in every court in the land, as we all know, and we finally broke ground on the 1st of July 2014, knowing that the coal that we were mining is actually highly oxidised, mainly thermal coal, wasn't coking coal that could be exported, but we had an existing contract with Holcim and we knew that Holcim was shutting in 2 years' time. So with the full knowledge of the vendor, we triggered the consents by opening the mine and we did really what is about 25% of the original construction work. We formed some dams, we formed some laydown areas, and probably most importantly, we formed the first engineered landform that allowed us then to use that as a scientific experiment platform to prove that the method that we'd identified to reduce the risk of acid mine drainage could work. And that was the structured placement of the acid forming material capped over with non-acid forming material, and then we had numbers of probes and stuff like that, and we've proven over time that that does work at a commercial scale. Now leading forward, 2016, we announced in October that we were successful with a bid for the Solar Energy assets. 2 weeks later we were served with a bill basically saying that we'd triggered the first $40 million payment because we'd moved more than 25,000 tonnes off the escarpment project. Obviously that coal had gone into Holcim not to export, hadn't been shipped. And we basically, obviously we said, no, we're not going to pay it for these reasons. We ended up in court in February 2018. The decision was handed down in August 18 and we were unsuccessful. We straight away appealed it on five different grounds. and we went into the appeal court on the 20th of August this year, and we're awaiting that decision. So we believe we've still got a good case. I mean, you know, our legal team did a really good job. We were really happy with the outcome of the 3 days in court. We didn't see anything come across there that gave us any sort of negative vibe out of that court. And obviously we don't control, there's three judges versus one judge in the High Court. And again, we are eagerly awaiting that decision. Now, if it goes against us, we are building cash within the business. We have got access to facilities, and it will not send us broke. So, you know, we believe we've got the ability to pay that if we had to pay it. At the present time, though, we don't believe we're going to have to pay it. So just looking at our assets across New Zealand, obviously we've got Maramarua and Rotowaro in the North Island and Stockton, held by the BT company, which is a joint venture between ourselves and Tellys. We own 65% of that joint venture. The Buller project, which is 100% owned by Bathurst and very much still alive. We've got the Canterbury mine just west of Christchurch, and we've got the Takatimi mine just north of Invercargill. We've got a head office in Wellington, and we've got a regional office that supports really the BT business and our marketing team in Christchurch. And then we've got a distribution yard that focuses on our really the dairy and the food side of our business out of Timaru. So about 50% of our production of 2.2 million tonnes will be export this year, and then a combination of the North and South Island makes up the other 50% of our production. We've got over 550 employees now, and we've already covered the revenue side of it. Yeah, 60% of our revenue is going to come from export and 40% from domestic in this next financial year. Just a brief look at our capital structure. We've got 1.7 billion shares on issue at the present time. Market cap of around about 190 million today. That's obviously been fluctuating up and down a little bit lately. And we've got about 156 million of convertible notes that are, and some performance rights that are yet to convert, but they will all convert. We've got 7.9 million US in debt, and we've got about 50 million in cash, including restricted deposits, as at the end of September. We spent 4.2 million on the share buyback last year, and obviously everyone's now received the dividend of around 0.3 cents per share, which was about 5.1 Aussie that went out in October. We've got three different analysts that are covering us: Euroz, Bell Potter, and CCZ out of Sydney. Euroz is out of Western Australia, out of Perth, and they've all got a valuation, you know, between 17 and 20 cents. So, you know, we're sitting there at 50% of those sort of valuations, and obviously a lot of it is due to the slide we just had before. Obviously, we've got this court case that's sitting there, it's uncertainty, and so it does put a bit of a blanket on our share price. The substantial shareholders has changed quite significantly, really, since the last AGM. Republic's still very much there, and in fact has grown their percentage based around the conversion of some of the original convertible notes. Tellys joined the register about 6 months ago. They now hold 12%. Crocodile Capital out of Europe has increased their holding quite significantly over the last 6 months as well, and we welcome them onto the register. And then Michael out of Singapore has been sitting around about 6.1 for quite a while now. So about 50% of our shareholding is still based in Singapore, but we are seeing a change around with a couple of Sydney-based instos that have come off, and with Crocodile coming on the register in quite a large way. So getting down to the more operational stuff. So we do set high standards for ourselves in health, safety, environment, and community. So just running through those really quickly, and we've had zero occupational health illnesses across the company, and that's a good result. We've also spent a lot of time and effort on our medical monitoring program. So one of the risks that we identified, if you look across the incidents in open cast coal mines, particularly across the world, about a third of the incidents that occur that are outside of the normal ones where you've got equipment failure or straight out disobedience come down to the health of the employee, and that manifests itself in a number of ways. Obviously you have the key ones, which is some poor guy or girl has a heart attack driving a big truck, But really the main one is around fatigue, and fatigue can manifest itself in a lot of different ways, and a lot of it is driven from the health of the person in the first place, and particularly as we get into longer shift lengths and longer shift rotations. So basically all of our employees are going through a health medical, which is based around the Queensland coal board system, been adapted for New Zealand. It's not quite as stringent as the Queensland one. It's been quite a battle to get that through, and we're about 88% of that through as we speak. So obviously any new employees coming on are subject to that as well. But in doing so, we've actually reduced our risk profile quite significantly in that traffic area. I mean, that's one of the key reasons we've done it. On our sites, the two things that will potentially could kill multiple people is big landslide type events where you've got high walls that could collapse, and or big truck meeting little truck. I mean, that's the thing that keep me awake at night. That's the thing that keeps our management team, you've got the Stockton guys here, awake at night as well. So that's the things that we've got to control. And one of the key controls, as I've said, is making sure the people that are driving that gear are in the best fitness they can be, and we understand what that profile looks like for each of those individual people. So that's quite an effort. So in terms of our total recordable injury rate, it's about 6.5. It's not where we want to be still. We've still got a lot of work to do to drive that down. That's about 18% down year on year where we were last year. And if you think of the, you know, we've gone from 75 employees to now over 550. We've had a significant rise, and we've now got to bring all them along for this journey that we started back in really 2015. We had no major environmental incidents. We've had 5 minor incidents, which mainly relates to dirty water being released off our sites. And we spent a lot of time and effort in managing those. And one of the key components is the environmental management system that's in place across the company. And we're reviewing that at the present time with a gap analysis against where we want to where we are now, and then putting together some programs to get ourselves where we actually want to be. And the other key thing, which is probably one of the reasons that we're in this room here today, is that, you know, on a regional and on a national scale, you know, we want to be important to our communities. We want to look after the communities that we're operating in, and we want to feel that they're getting benefit from having us in their region. So obviously, you know, we're in Southland. We're one of the largest employers in that area. We're not the largest employer in the Canterbury area. In fact, we're up in the hills. Not many people know we're there. Obviously, we're a large employer in Westport. We're a large employer in the Huntly area, which is quite a low socioeconomic group, and that even though it's in the middle of the North Island. So we believe we're important in those areas. We're to make sure that the people in there believe we're important. And one of the key things there is understanding what stakeholders want and what we can deliver to them. So we spend a lot of time and effort on that as well. So really just talking that through, obviously New Zealand government, you know, has been moving forward with a transition to a net zero economy. There was a new law passed in New Zealand, for anyone that's not familiar, about 2 months ago, which then now will be enacted, and that will set up a climate change commission. The commission has been appointed, and that'll then start setting targets to take New Zealand in that direction by 2050. And Bathurst supports that transition, but obviously fully understanding that our emissions, we're not mining piles of coal, putting them out on the side on the side of the street with a for sale sign on it. Every ton that leaves our mine is every ton that's mined is sold. And these customers are using that coal to the betterment of New Zealand's economy. So, you know, it's, whether it's value add to primary production, whether it's going into steel making in the North Island, which supplies about 65% of the steel needs of New Zealand, or whether it's going into, you know, basically keeping the lights on in Auckland by running the Huntly Power Station, those emissions are embedded in this community, in this economy. So, you know, we do make a contribution, and a valuable contribution, and it's not just a matter of turning off and saying we can take, improve New Zealand's emissions by getting rid of all coal use. That's going to have about a 3% or 3.5% effect on the amount of emissions that are coming out of New Zealand. But it'll have a huge effect on dairy and food manufacturing in the North Island and in the South Island, where there's no alternative in terms of gas or electricity, but also in the North Island in terms of, you know, the whole steel industry out of One Steel. We are focusing on steel production, as I've sort of said multiple times during so far. I mean, a large proportion of our revenue comes from that now, and we want to grow that proportion. And again, without repeating myself, we do see, you know, coal being used in steel production through the life of certainly our assets that we've got here and potentially in the Canadian asset. We are looking to sort of have some geographical diversity. So we've managed that from 15 up to 17. We're now in the North and South Island of New Zealand. We've looked at the assets across there. We don't see any further growth opportunities, both in terms of the domestic and the export business. So that's why we're moving into Canada. We looked at a couple of assets in Australia, but at the time it was the top of the market and they were very expensive, and also quite a long lag between taking them on as a project to being an operation. So we want something that's a bit more near production. Internally, we are looking to reduce our Scope 1 and Scope 2 emissions. So that's our diesel use, our electricity use. Some of our sites still rely on site-based gensets, for instance. We're not connected to the mains power system. The recent purchase of the block of land at Canterbury, which got OIO approval a couple of months ago, allows us then to put the actual reticulated power, mains power, into the mine, which obviously then gives us the benefit of having 85% of that coming from renewables, or even in the South Island situation, 100% of that coming from renewables. And we're looking for other options, both in terms of efficiency, but also in terms of emissions with our diesel use. The other thing that's sort of come as part of our development strategy is we bought and developed the Canterbury mine because it's 18 kilometres from the Darfield dairy factory. And the supplier prior to that was coming 240 kilometres away. So obviously, the emissions in terms of the transport of that coal from the mine to the user is significantly less by operating out of the Canterbury mine, and that's obviously been recognised by Fonterra. And I think, I've already sort of covered this point, but we are going to work with our industrial customers and we want to lockstep with them. So we are not going to go and develop further resources or reserves unless it's in lockstep with a customer who's already basically signed up and wants that coal longer term. Stocked a mine, which you'll visit today if you get that opportunity. We're going to do about 1.3 million tonnes of sales. Our costs are about 107 Kiwi delivered to the boat. So that's sort of putting us in the sort of 70 to 75 US delivered costs at the present time. So it's probably in the lower third of the cost curve. We're going to make about 70 million EBITDA out of there. We've got a good reserve and resource and reserve base and a good set of infrastructure in that the washery was built in 2010. It's got a capacity of 1.8 million tonnes. The area was a little bit older than that. It was built in 1954, but it's been continually upgraded and maintained, and it's done 2.2 million tonnes in the past, as well as the rail loadout. And as I've said before, we've also then got scalable port and rail contracts, and we've got a customer base that has taken up to 2.2 million tonnes from this operation, so we've got plenty of capacity. Over the last couple of years, we have increased our sales in the semi-hard and decreased our sales in the hard coking coal and the sort of a mop-up high ash coking coal proportion. And that's really in a reaction to the remaining reserve within the operation. So our two main pits, Millerton and Cypress, make up the most of that blend. And then we've got a number of other pits, which you'll see today again, which we use for trimmers. So whether it's for sulfur or Romax or ash, there's a number of pits that we can use and levers we can pull to make sure each boat going out meets the spec of our customer. And the thing is with that New Zealand coal, it's not going to compete directly in a blast furnace with coal, say from the Queensland. I mean, it's very low ash. No boat goes out with more than 5% ash. It's got almost 100% vitrinite, which is the really reactive part of coal. And it's used as a blend improver. So as I said, the Japanese market, Mitsubishi Chemical have been a customer of Stockton for 45 years next year. And they only take, a few boatloads a year, but every blend that's going into their coke ovens has a small amount of Stockton coal in it. And they use it to offset the properties of other coals they're bringing in bulk. And it's probably even more enhanced for Tata in the Indian market. The Indian coals tend to be high ash and low vitrinite content. So a small amount of New Zealand coal going into there means they can use more of their domestic coals. And probably just as importantly in terms of a low emission environment is that the addition of New Zealand coal means they use less coal overall. So that's our main value and use basis that we actually sell this coal on. And so the emissions per tonne of steel is less. We've got now a new customer in OneSteel. We've just signed a contract up with them. Hyundai is a new customer, old customers long established in Japan and India. We have got relationships into China, but we're not doing any coal into China over this next 12-month period. An exciting project that we've really been ticking away at since we took over the mine The A18 dam was formed in 2010 to take the fine coal material out of the washery. There's no flotation circuit on the existing Stockton washery. There's about 2 million tonnes of washery reject. And sort of looking forward, we need to build another dam. So we've actually signed off on the capital for that this year, and we're commencing doing that. That'll be lower down in the sequence. But there's about 1 million tonnes of product tied up in this dam. And what it needs then is about a capital project of around 32 million, the addition of a flotation circuit to our plant, which we're looking to do as a standalone circuit, and a way of getting that material out of there safely and efficiently, which is some sort of a dredge type setup. So we're looking to sort of bring that forward as a project. It's a pre-fee stage now, sometime towards the middle of next year. It's looking feasible at the moment. We've still got to work through some of the finer capital costs. But potentially that's 100,000 tonnes a year for the next 10 years coming out of that dam. It decreases our environmental liability because A18 is actually quite high up in the sequence and quite close to the escarpment. So by actually retreating that material, we'll bring it lower down. The reject material out of that reject will then go into a dam that's lower in the sequence and further away from the major escarpments and the major water outlets. Our domestic business, as I said, about half our coal is going to come from that. It's good, consistent EBITDA, considering those two numbers for the North Island and South Island are after paying the corporate overhead for BT and for Bathurst. And it's underpinned by long-term contracts and our basically underpinned by our life of mine plan. So each of the mines now has got a life of mine plan. We understand where we're going to be. We understand what our costs are going to be. And we're using those plans now to go forward in terms of renegotiating or recontracting any of that coal. And we've got good reserve base at each of those mines. We don't have to go into major programs of resource to reserve conversion. But as we sort of deplete that, we'll then work in lockstep with our customers to bring it forward so we don't end up with stranded asset. So we've got the Buller project that we're working away on at the present time, and that is looking that we're aiming to have coal production coming out of there 2022-23. We've also got some organic growth projects within the Stockton original footprint, so they're either in the coal mining licence or in the Upper Waimangaroa mining permit. So around about 18 million tonnes of resource there. We've also got projects in the North Island, Maramarua and Rotowaro with the Waipuna West and the Waipuna West extension. There's another resource quite close to Rotowaro within the existing sort of infrastructure footprint that we're investigating. And then the Ruawara or Rotowaro North project, which is about the same distance to the north of our existing infrastructure as we're mining in the south at the present time. We've got a project team that's looking at that. So that sort of project pipeline, again, is what we're talking to New Zealand Steel and less importantly, I suppose, to Genesis in terms of a long-term coal supply for them to meet their business needs. And then underpinning that as well, we've got extension projects at Canterbury and at Takatimu that will allow the existing sort of production profile to be carried forward for the next 15 or so years. And then that brings us to Canada. Obviously, back we started looking around in 2017. We engaged with Jameson around that time, looked to do a joint venture. We ended up doing an earn-in. And at the present time, we regard that as being very successful. So we invested in the exploration program back in 2018 calendar year. The results of that were a little bit delayed. We got those early this year. That's allowed us then, though, to basically underpin the development of the bankable feasibility study and also to feed into the environmental studies that are going on at the moment. So we've signed off and we've invested what we call tranche one. So that takes us to 20% now of the project for the investment of about 11.5 million Canadian. We are continuing forward with that investment. So we've allocated about $5 million over the next 18 months to continue with the development of the BFS and the environmental studies. And then we get an investment decision. So once we've got the permits, once we've got the land accesses, and obviously assuming that the project is financeable and we have that finance in place, then we invest $110 million. That $110 million goes in as the first seed capital for the build. And that takes us then to 50% of the project. So overall, we're looking to produce somewhere between 1.5 and 2 million tonnes of clean coking coal per year. It's going to be in the range of 92% plus of the benchmark coming out of Queensland over the resource overall. The initial north block is actually a high quality, so it'll get a closer to 100%, a little bit less. And the key milestones at the moment are the bankable feasibility study and the environmental permitting application. So sort of just going back to strategy again, just for a quick glimpse, obviously, you know, we were looking at the current opportunity. So we're pretty much maxed out for domestic in New Zealand. And we've looked across our holdings within our South Island, in particular coking coal business. And as we see from the, you know, the project pipeline, we've got two streams identified there, the Buller project, which is 100% Bathurst. And then we've got growth projects that can replace existing pits within Stockton as we go forward. And again, we're pretty much maxed out. We're not going to do much more than about 1.5 million tonnes, 1.6 maybe, out of export out of the South Island. So, you know, to be able to reach our goal of 5 million tonnes under management, we needed to go and look for further assets. So, as again, we looked at some in Australia. We came across this project in BC, British Columbia, held by a good company called Jameson, and it's right in a really well-known coking coal precinct. So the yellow-coloured blobs here are holdings of Teck. Teck mines and sells about 25 million tonnes out of here per annum. They're the second largest coking coal exporter in the world. And this obviously is sitting right in the middle. Now, it's too small for Teck. That's why it's still available. It has been held by Teck in the past. But it's in a precinct that's got a lot of interest. I mean, Grassy Mountain has been subject to a takeover by Gina Rinehart recently for a lot of money. There's also projects directly to the south of by companies called Montem and North Coal. So there's a lot of interest in this area, and we believe we've got a really good holding sitting in there in the middle of that precinct, which is well known. And so, yeah, that's where it sort of fits in. It's going to grow us in terms of coking coal production, and as I said, takes us up to an additional 2 million tonnes under management. So just looking at the timeline, the baseline studies have been completed for that project. We're working our way through the environmental assessment application. Russell and I had a review with the project team over there a couple of weeks ago, and everything looks to be on track. The feasibility study has been handled by a company called Stantec, and they're anticipating that we're going to have a first draft of that in February, March, early next year, which we'll then sit down and review with them. The environmental assessment is due to be completed around about May. Will be a review period, and then we'll submit that for adequacy testing with a regulator in June of 20, and then that triggers then around about, well, it's a minimum of a 9-month process, normally runs between 12 and 18 months. So we're taking a view that's going to take us around about 15 months to get that out. So if you follow through all those, and then there's the mining permit application, which will run concurrent with the environmental application. Obviously, financing and then construction, we're looking to have production coming out during the calendar year 22. This is really our last slide. And the reason I like this slide is it shows the growth and where we've come from and the growth going forward. So, you know, Bathurst back in FY17, we made a small profit. We mined 400,000 tonnes, sold it all domestically into food manufacturing, value add to prime production. Obviously, FY18, we took over the solid energy assets on the 1st of September 17. 10 months worth of operations under those. We made 96 million EBITDA. Repeated that this year or the last year with 107 million EBITDA. We're looking to do similar numbers this year, around 80 million, with the export coking coal price coming off a little bit. Repeatable the next year, and then we start seeing the Buller project and the Canadian project starting to kick in small amounts of coal and growing over the next couple of years up to 5 million tonnes. So, you know, when we're looking at FY25 or 24-25, at long-term consensus pricing, which is around 150 US, you know, we're looking at a business that's tuning in at Bathurst level about 250 to 275 million EBITDA. So that's the growth profile we're looking for. And I think just as importantly though, still underpinned by that domestic business that is still based around steelmaking, but still also around value add to primary production. And as we've seen, we've got the projects to support that going forward for another 10 to 15 years. So look, we've then got the usual statements in terms of the resource and reserve numbers that have been used in there, and that's part of the presentation.